So, good evening to all. On behalf of the Department of Public Law at this Faculty of Law, it's my privilege to extend a very warm welcome to you all. This is the last seminar in a three-night series titled, very appropriately, Wildlife in Crisis. Over the past two evenings, we had been fortunate enough to be exposed to the contributions of a wide range of speakers drawn from government, activist and lobbyist circles, policy consultants, and academics. I think we have traveled quite a distance over the last two evenings. And we have felt ourselves at times very comfortable in our shared consensus about the nature of the crisis, and I think quite appropriately also quite divided on the best policy options for the future. For those of you that were not here, the first evening was really aimed at a brief contextualization, a mapping exercise, if you wish, of the problem of wildlife poaching, the nature of the consumer market in Asia, and some of the efforts towards building international partnerships, and lastly, a very brief mapping exercise of the nature of the relationships between people out there and protected areas. Now, this attempt at contextualization, as far as I could tell, did not encounter major differences of opinion. In fact, a certain amiable, warm consensus prevailed in this very room. Last night, the discussion focused on possible, what was called at some point solutions, but probably more accurately, regulatory responses. And there was a call by one speaker and specifically that our discussions needed to be realistic and sustainable. Now, I'm a sociologist, not a lawyer. And I could tell by the way that the bodies started to move in the seats that there was no longer a comfortable consensus. Body language is an intriguing area of study because it does position people into clusters of groups, and they ooh and they are, and they become uncomfortable in very intriguing ways. And that is what I saw last night. So reading beyond the surface of civility and politeness, it's probably fair to say that we encountered real controversies. And rightly so, because these issues are complex and they are very emotive. And some of those differences of opinion were political, they were ideological, and academical. Between, if you wish to juxtapose things, pro-trade and anti-trade. However, I suspected that somewhere along the discussions of last night, that kind of sharp juxtaposition started to give way, ever so slightly, to the recognition that what we need is a reimagination of solutions. Beyond the comfortable juxtapositions and the competing orthodoxies. So for purpose of such a reimagination, I'm wondering whether we should not take the voice from Mexico very seriously. Because Professor Nadal, perhaps in some of his writing, has insisted that whatever positions we take, we have a responsibility as academics to assemble empirical data and enough of that to back up the claims that we make. But that empirical data has furthermore has to be subjected to logical scrutiny and theoretical consistency. And I hope that that challenge provides a unifying element for our conversations this evening. So this evening, we turn to a consideration of legal, investigative, and prosecutorial challenges that we confront at the moment. And I am calling upon my colleague, Mr. Cullingham, to open this evening more properly and to preside over the proceedings.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Cormac Cullinan, and I'll be the chair tonight. The debate's been so interesting so far that there's so many very well-informed people in the room that I'm going to do my best to be as unobtrusive as possible. We have a lot of speakers tonight, so we're going to have to move fairly swiftly through the program, and I appeal to all the speakers to do your best to keep to your allocated times so that we can allow some a reasonable amount of time at the end for discussion and debate, because I think that is the place where the real possibilities of new approaches and ways forward will emerge. Tonight we have a stellar cast of speakers, and the program has been arranged so that we start at the international level and then zoom down to the Western Cape. So we start with John Sellar, who is the former CITES law enforcement chief and is now an anti-smuggling fraud and organized crime consultant. Then we go to Bonaventure Ebayi, the director of the Lusaka Agreement on Cooperative Enforcement Operations. Then Paula Kahumbu, CEO of WildlifeDirect. Antoinette Ferreira, a senior advocate and specialist environmental and organized crime prosecutor of the National Prosecuting Authority here in South Africa. And finally, Paul Gildenhuys, the manager of biodiversity enforcement in CapeNature here in the Western Cape. I'm going to ask each of the speakers to make their presentations consecutively, and we'll save up all the discussions for the end. Once all of them have spoken, I'm going to ask the whole panel to come to the front here and to field questions from where they're sitting. And I am quite sure after the debate last night that there will be a very interesting discussion. And hopefully with the accumulated wisdom and expertise and commitment to saving rhinos that we have here in the room, that we'll get some really interesting outcomes.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to start by thanking the University of Cape Town, the Conservation Trust, and particularly the Global Initiative Against Transnational Organized Crime. Let me just take a moment to say that if you don't know anything about the Global Initiative, I recommend that you go to their website, because it is the most incredible resource for information about transnational organized crime. I should also at the start say that the last time I gave this speech was in South Africa's maximum security prison, so I apologize to those of you who will have heard it before. This, I think, has been a tremendous seminar, and of course it's about to get even better. Someone sent me an email a few weeks ago and asked, given the degree of political attention that is being given to this subject and the apparent increase in allocated resources, why is wildlife crime not reducing? And I think that's an excellent question, and it probably deserves to be posed more often. On the other hand, though, it's probably not easily answered. And I think part of the problem reflects the title of my address, which is, you know, what is the real issue here? And I think until we determine what the issue is, it's not going to be easy to have a straightforward response. So what is the issue? Well, in fact, if you consider the speakers at this conference, you might think it's a military matter, a diplomatic or political problem, something for the conservation community, a socio-economic question, weaknesses in legislation, or an enforcement challenge. Now, the recent conference on illegal wildlife trade that was held in Kasane, Botswana, appears to have thought that there were four relevant issues. And I base this upon the themes that were in the identified in the statement that emerged from that conference. And they were eradicating the markets for illegal wildlife products, ensuring effective legal frameworks and deterrence, strengthening law enforcement, and lastly, sustainable livelihoods and economic development. However, I noticed that several NGOs, perhaps more used to using sort of soundbite language, have started to summarize things as follows. Stop the killing, stop the trafficking, stop the demand. Now, I think regardless of the words used to describe them, each of these issues or themes is a relatively specialized area, and it requires appropriate experts and practitioners to consider how they should be tackled, and very importantly, set about tackling them. However, to date, that does not seem to be the response. The response appears to be, have another conference. Within weeks, Kasane was followed by an event in Brazzaville. Its outcomes are going to be discussed next month by the African Union at a summit here in South Africa. There is talk of the UN General Assembly adopting a resolution on wildlife trafficking. And then the Kasane conference is going to be followed up by another conference in Vietnam next year. Since March 2013, wildlife crime has been discussed at international or regional events held in the following cities: Arusha, Bangkok, Bishkek, Bonn, Brussels, Cancun, Doha, Gaborone, Geneva, Johannesburg, Hanoi, Kuwait, London, Monte Carlo, Nairobi, New York, Paris, Sydney, Tokyo, Vienna, Washington, D.C., and Yaoundé. Now, I'm confident I will have missed people off that list, so I apologize. And these are just the formal events. These don't take account of the myriad of other sort of get-togethers. Who attends these conferences? It is primarily politicians, senior civil servants, heads of national park, forestry or wildlife bodies, and representatives of intergovernmental organizations and the NGO community. I suspect you would see the same faces time and time again. I've no problem with the nature of the attendees. What does trouble me, and considerably, is who has not been present. Let's consider just one of those meetings, one of the biggies, the London conference last year on illegal wildlife trade. It was high profile, and it demonstrated that these days, you don't just see ministers, you get heads of state turning up. This UK government event was hosted by Prime Minister Cameron, and it was chaired by the Foreign Secretary. Now that's undoubtedly impressive, but actually, is it relevant? If one agrees, as I think one surely must do these days, that organized crime now plays a major role in wildlife trafficking, then surely the issue for discussion is not illicit trade, it's crime. If the British government had hosted a gathering, international event to discuss firearms or human trafficking, would you not have expected its Home Secretary to have chaired it? If it had an event looking at crime, if the Commissioner of the Metropolitan Police or the Director General of its National Crime Agency had not been invited to be keynote speakers, I think they would have been pretty offended. Now, the fact that none of the UK's leading political figures or senior officials responsible for crime matters played any part speaks volumes, or it does to me. Nations and the international community have devoted hundreds of thousands of dollars, euros, pounds, whatever, bringing the wrong people together. There was a time when that money was needed to raise awareness and to garner political support. And it was spent successfully. But that time, ladies and gentlemen, is behind us. Enough is enough. Now it is time for action. And for that, we need a new set of players around the table. This particular conference is entitled Wildlife in Crisis, Wars, Laws, and Consumers. Allow me to focus on one of those issues, wars. About 2 years ago, the Global Initiative Against Transnational Organized Crime was good enough to publish my reflections on whether lessons can be learned from the wars against firearms and drugs that can be used in the war against wildlife crime. And I believe that there were and are. But I want to consider a different element this evening, and one that was not addressed in that paper. If we are truly engaged in a war against wildlife crime, are we waging it in a manner that reflects the approaches that we have taken apparently successfully in the past? The contemporary war probably doesn't need an Eisenhower, a Patton, a MacArthur, or a Montgomery, but it certainly warrants better management and leadership than seems to exist at the moment. If we were to staff a war room against transnational organized crime, who should our field marshals and five-star generals be? Who are the right people to direct efforts to stop the killing and stop the trafficking? The core business of wildlife, game, forest, and national park agencies around the world is not law enforcement. Indeed, if you're a junior member of staff there and you want to make a career, it wouldn't suit you, it wouldn't serve you to focus on enforcement. So that inadvertently, we have found ourselves often in a situation, and I've encountered this in many countries, whereby the persons who hold senior management positions in those organizations have no experience of law enforcement, particularly intelligence and investigations, and indeed, they may have no appreciation of the needs for enforcement. And few of them will have regular contact with or close working relationships with their peers in agencies such as customs, police, public prosecutions, or financial crime agencies. And yet, it is commonly and regularly those individuals who governments around the globe, and particularly in developing countries, are turning to and expecting them to lead their nation's response to organized wildlife crime. Not only is that tactic not effective, it isn't fair on those peoples. Now, some governments choose to place senior military figures in charge or in positions of coordination. And that's understandable, given the characteristics of much of today's poaching. And it also reflects concerns you will have about incursions across your nation's borders. It's also appropriate when you recognize that a lot of anti-poaching work is paramilitary in nature. However, and here I have to stress that I mean no disrespect whatsoever to one of the speakers earlier this week who struck me as a very impressive individual. The cop in me makes me believe that strategies, military strategies, should always only be temporary. A militaristic answer may stop the killing, but it will not stop the trafficking. Many countries are commendably convening multi-agency groups or task forces that bring together the variety of skills and expertise needed to combat organized criminals and to bring them to justice. Some of these take the form of national wildlife enforcement networks, WENs. And indeed, I think in Southern Africa, you've recently established one of these. However, one regularly finds such groupings to be chaired by wildlife, forestry, or CITES personnel, and not representatives of mainstream law enforcement bodies. One knock-on effect of this, which we are regularly seeing, is that existing communication channels, for example, those of Interpol or the World Customs Organization, are not employed as much as they either should or could be. You would not appoint someone from the pharmaceutical industry to head a task force combating narco-trafficking. So why assign a CITES administrator to lead the war against fauna and flora-related criminality? Another knock-on effect of the current approaches is that they tend, again, to reinforce the impression that what we are dealing with is illicit trade and not crime. Now, I don't intend to demean in the slightest what senior officials of wildlife, forest, and parks departments are doing. And I certainly do not devalue in situ protection. Anti-poaching work involves specialized skills, very considerable bravery, and it is utterly essential. Every time a rhino is killed or an elephant's tusk is smuggled across a border, we have lost a battle. However, if you focus too much on anti-poaching, you are not going to win the war. I spoke earlier of my conviction that a new set of players has to come to the table. Now, I'm reluctant to suggest that we have more conferences, but I earnestly believe that reaching out to senior managers and policymakers in the law enforcement and prosecution communities is long overdue. They need to be engaged, and they need to be convinced of the vital role that they have to play here. So they must either be invited to future conferences or standalone events should be held at either international or regional levels. Because it is they who ought to be designing, agreeing, adopting, and implementing the strategies required to deal with organized crime, not politicians, conservationists, or campaigners. But we also, of course, have to have practical effort too alongside the strategies. Three initiatives occurred during my service as Chief of Enforcement for CITES, and I think they're relevant to our discussions this evening. The first of those was the International Consortium on Combating Wildlife Crime. Then we had the CITES Enforcement Task Forces, and finally we had the CITES Enforcement Expert Group. Now, I'm not going to talk about the consortium this evening. But the latter, or in fact all of them, were intended to bring together agencies or individuals with expertise in relevant fields of anti-poaching, border control, policing, intelligence, investigation, and prosecution. The CITES task forces were designed to address species-specific matters, whilst the expert group was intended to look at law enforcement in general. Now, the task forces continue to meet, but in my view, not regularly enough. The expert group has not been convened since 2009. Now, arguably, the greatest benefit of the CITES enforcement task forces was that they got the right people together in one room, the people who were actually dealing with the problem day to day, whatever that was. For example, the illegal harvest of great apes in Africa and Asia, and their subsequent sale, live or dead. In my day, no meetings were kept of those meetings, and only representatives of law enforcement bodies were invited to attend. Because the intention was to create an atmosphere where officers from one nation could sit down with counterparts from another, talk frankly, openly, exchange confidential information, get to know each other, and plan how to work together. They also enabled those of us working at the international level to get an insight into the modus operandi with regards to species-specific crime that we had never been able to do previously. However, apart from schemes such as those and high-profile things like the Operation Cobra at the international level, the officials who are actively engaged in investigating wildlife trafficking have next to no opportunities to interact with their opposite numbers face-to-face. There are umpteen projects, plans and funds that finance work in relation to conservation activities, community involvement, demand reduction, and anti-poaching. But the investigator who tracks a case to his nation's border and wishes to pursue it further, sitting down with customs in perhaps a country of transit along the way, and then police at the country of destination, often cannot, because his agency hasn't the money. Investigation in all its forms to track down those who control the poaching, smuggling, and dealing, and who reap the greatest profits, is probably the area at the moment that is receiving the least donor support and aid. The harsh reality is that wildlife crime remains a low priority for most mainstream law enforcement agencies. And it's likely to remain so unless we prompt some changes. Plus, many of those agencies are today constantly having to deal with everyday crime with budgets that governments are cutting because of the global recession. So if you mean it, when you call out, stop the trafficking, then it's time to put more resources where they are needed. Some form of international contingency fund perhaps has to be created so that it can support cross-border investigations. Not though for sort of high-profile, planned months in advance, catchy-titled operations, but for cases that are currently going nowhere because a customs or police agency's budget cannot be stretched to cover forensic tests, undertake covert surveillance or controlled operations, controlled deliveries, or just engage in meaningful and practical cross-border liaison. There are quite a number of poachers, pseudo-hunters, smugglers, and dealers sitting behind bars at the moment, and that's very welcome. But how many of those who recruited, equipped, financed, or paid them are in jail? Precious few. Alejandro, who spoke earlier this week, likes things to be measured effectively. So in Scotland, we actually have a measurement for this type of thing. And the scale to reflect the number of, you know, organized crime guys that are in jail, it ends up on the scale as being next to bugger all. So what is the real issue here? I believe it is crime. In fact, it can maybe be narrowed down further to simply crime investigation. Personally, I regard all other issues, be they conservation, demand reduction, community involvement, awareness raising, political engagement, or whatever, to be ancillary. Ladies and gentlemen, wildlife trafficking is going to go on relentlessly until we either bring the people controlling it to justice or we make it too risky for it to be profitable for them. To do that, we need to engage with the senior managers and policymakers of those agencies around the world who deal with organized crime. And we have to get them on board. And then we have to get them to deploy their investigators. And following that, we need to support those investigators. Can it really be that simple? I believe it can. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Bonaventure Ebayi. I'm a forester ecologist and law enforcement officer, currently director of Lusaka Agreement Task Force based in Nairobi, Kenya. On behalf of the Lusaka Agreement Task Force, I wish at the outset to express our sincere gratitude for the kind invitation to this conference. Specifically by Professor Mark Shaw, the Director of the Global Initiative Against Transnational Organized Crime, and the Center of Criminology of his estimate University of Cape Town. I feel personally honored to participate in this important event, and as a panelist in these seminars, during which I will be able to highlight some work of the Lusaka Agreement Task Force, and also emerging issues, as well as contribute to the debate, which is very timely in view of the current worrying trends of wildlife crime and associated illicit trade. Wildlife crime or wildlife crises affect all African range states and most species, while the elephant and the rhinos remains the most threatened across the continent. And this is mainly driven by criminal networks to meet the lucrative ivory and horn trade demand, which is outside the continent. In terms of achievement and the challenges of the regional multilateral environmental agreement, I would like to bring to your attention the case of the Lusaka Agreement. Regarding the context, as my predecessor has just said, wildlife crime is depriving developing economies of billions of dollars in lost revenue and development opportunities. Wildlife crime is a fast-growing international organized crime, which encompassing a wide range of flora and fauna across all continents. In Africa, taxa involved include various timber species, great apes, elephants, rhinos, bat, pangolin, reptiles, and fisheries. It is a complex problem that requires complex solution, combined approaches to be addressed effectively. Sensitization and education at all levels, enforcement and compliance, research and demand reduction, strong commitment and investment by government and international community, appropriate policies and engagement with consumers. In terms of consequences of wildlife crime in Africa particularly, wildlife crime is seen as a development issue also in relation to the social, economic, and environmental consequences. These consequences associated with wildlife crime include threat to national and international security, transmission of diseases from animals to people, degradation of ecosystem and ecosystem services, loss of biodiversity, loss of revenues from ecotourism negatively affect livelihood, especially in rural communities. It also undermines good governance and the rule of law. Regarding the response to this serious crime, and because of its cross-border nature, the effort to combat wildlife crime requires international cooperation. In Africa, for example, the Lusaka Agreement on Cooperative Enforcement Operation, directed at illegal trade in wild fauna and flora, was adopted as a regional response to promote cooperation among states to effectively combat wildlife crime. The Lusaka Agreement is a regional environmental treaty whose objective is to reduce and ultimately eliminate illegal trade in wild fauna and flora. And for that purpose, to establish a permanent task force to coordinate state effort in combating wildlife crime. The agreement complements the role of CITES and other biodiversity conventions, such as CBD and CMS, as well as multilateral organization conservation initiatives, including of sub-regional economic blocs in Africa. The Lusaka Agreement was adopted in 1994, and it came into force in 1996. It is deposited with the UN Secretary General in New York and registered as a UN environmental treaty. It is open for accession to all African states. Currently, 10 countries have signed the agreement, out of which 7 are actively participating in the implementation of the agreement, and also 3 countries who have already signed but are yet to ratify, including the Republic of South Africa. For the implementation of this agreement, there are a three-tier organization structure which was put in place, comprising the Governing Council, the National Bureau, and the Task Force. The Governing Council is a ministerial-level policy and decision-making body, which is responsible for reviewing and the implementation of the agreement and also adopting all strategies and program of work for the implementation of the agreement. National bureaus of the agreement are national enforcement implementing bodies, which are mainly wildlife authorities. The Task Force on Cooperative Enforcement Operation, which is also the secretariat and operational arm of the agreement, is known as the Lusaka Agreement Task Force. The Lusaka Agreement structure provides a political and legal framework for transnational cooperation. The Lusaka Agreement Task Force started its operation in 1999 with a cross-border mandate to facilitate cooperation between member states in addressing wildlife crime, mainly in Africa. Over the years, LATIF delivers support to strengthen the capacities of member states to prevent, investigate, and prosecute crime against species of wild fauna and flora, but focusing on rare, protected, and endangered ones. LATIF conducts all its activities within the framework of 4 key result areas in line with provision of the Lusaka Final Act 1994, rule of the organization, and the strategic plan, out of which are drawn program of work. These areas comprise capacity development, cooperation, cooperative law enforcement activities, developing partnership, and expansion of the membership. The successes of international cooperation include mainly the development of cross-border enforcement mechanism between member states and their neighboring countries. Currently, there are 6 active bilateral cross-border mechanisms involving 14 countries in Africa. In terms of enforcement operation, all enforcement-led, intelligence-led enforcement operations are aimed at disruption of illegal international wildlife trade syndicates. And this is done mainly through intelligence gathering and sharing of information. Also, regularly we issue alerts to affected countries. Intelligence-led enforcement operation at national and sub-regional level, which involve countries working together. Regional, inter-regional, and global intelligence-led enforcement operations, which assist also in bridging source, transit, and destination countries. The Operation Cobra is one of the examples of such multi-regional operation, which was undertaken in 2011, and 2013, and 2014. And currently, Operation Cobra 3 is ongoing. It started on 4th of May 2015, and will be continuing up to the end of this month. In addition to this operation, Cobra, other similar operations were also coordinated by the Lusaka Agreement Task Force in conjunction with Interpol and World Customs Organization. The task force has been critical in facilitating information exchange between source and seizing countries, also undertaking complex and high-profile inter-regional investigation into transnational wildlife crime. Currently, it is involved in more than 30 investigations into wildlife seizures, mainly made overseas, outside Africa. The task force has also facilitated the repatriation of wildlife contraband back to country of origin in line with CITES provisions. And this is mainly for law enforcement purposes, has evidence in court, or to support sensitization and awareness program. Currently, we account for more than 9 tons of ivory, which we are repatriated from Singapore to Kenya, Zambia, and Malawi. And also an additional 118 leopard tortoises, which we are repatriated from Hong Kong to Tanzania. We are still pursuing with other countries in Asia for repatriation of more contraband on the request of the countries. To enhance our effectiveness in what we are undertaking as the Lusaka Agreement Task Force, we embark in development of partnership. And currently, we are working in partnership with UNEP, with CITES Secretariat, with Interpol, World Customs Organization. We are also a member of a GRASP partnership. We work with the Faculty of Biology of Washington University, the UNU Japan University, and also the Netherlands University of Twente. We have an MOU with the COMIFAC, which is the Commission for Forest of Central Africa. We have also an MOU with REXA, which is the Regional Center for Small Arm, and the relevant conservation NGOs like AIFO. This allowed development and implementation of joint programs and also exploring funding opportunities. It has also assisted in increased awareness on wildlife among partners, leading to development of various initiatives under Interpol, under Wildlife World Customs Organization, and many other organizations. This has also contributed to enhance the momentum, global momentum against illegal trade and poaching across Africa and the world at large. The task force contributed to the development of the African Elephant Ivory Database for DNA profiling. This is mainly for law enforcement purposes to establish the origin of the ivory, so as to identify the range which could have been affected in the chain of crime. This has been a successful initiative, which is currently the main laboratory which is carrying out DNA profiling for ivory for all the countries. Latif also is involved in pioneering the implementation of a wildlife enforcement monitoring system, which is a common platform database used by wildlife authorities to share data and also to be able to analyze and establish the trends in the sub-region and also at national level. Currently, the task force is also involved in the development of the African Common Strategy on combating illegal trade and exploitation of African fauna and flora. This is one of the initiatives which came out from the recently concluded International Conference on Wildlife Crime held in Brazzaville, Congo. And the strategy will be submitted to the African Union Summit for adoption and implementation by all African countries. In terms of increased capacities, we realize it is important to continue building capacities of national agencies, and we work with national agencies and partners also to undertake training courses, specifically on intelligence and investigation, detection, and fostering cooperation among agencies. We also do inter-agency workshops, which bring all the enforcement agencies at national level together, even if they cannot be working as a one agency, but to support each other in all enforcement matter regarding the fight against wildlife crime. We have been also involved in the provision of specialized equipment to match up the science and technology in law enforcement. In everything we do, our main expectation is to see illegal trade minimized to lay way for legal wildlife trade, contributing to sustainable development across Africa and worldwide. This is one of the areas which we think, if we could be able to control and take the control of the wildlife criminal network, it will be possible for Africa to dream trading in wildlife. It is also important for us to dream increased global momentum in support of the fight against wildlife crime. This is already experienced through all the conferences which have been undertaken during the last 5 years. This shows the commitment and also the understanding of the international community that wildlife crime is a serious matter which means to be addressed collectively. We expect also increased cooperation and collaboration among states, without which we will not be able to win the war against wildlife crime. Increased level of funding and number of funding facilities and opportunities. It is very important. Everything we plan Without money, without funding, it's not possible to realize them. Enforcement institution and personal capacity build as appropriate. As my predecessor said, it's not possible to win the war against wildlife crime if you are working with officers who are not skilled enough to address the situation. So it is important that the institution dealing with wildlife crime are strengthened and officer well-trained to be able to undertake their duties. Increased number of enforcement operation and capacity building. Enforcement operation should not be a matter of project, but it should be a day-to-day work. So it is very important for enforcement agencies to have enough resources and enough capacities to be able to do it on a day-to-day basis. Increased number of countries with strong legislation. Currently, most of the countries in Africa are still reviewing their legislation. It is very important when we are talking about wildlife crime at international level, and if this is not factored in the national legislation as such, so we are working almost at different levels. We are talking about wildlife crime, but within the national legislations are simply petty offenses in most of the countries. So it's not possible for us to involve the criminal justice to deal with petty offenses. It is important for countries to continue reviewing their legislation to take into consideration the seriousness of the wildlife crime. Expanded informant network and database facilities. This is one of the areas we feel important to be addressed urgently, because most countries and most organizations are looking for data. We are looking for information, criminal information. But without expanded informant network in our countries, it's not possible for us to dream to be able to get the necessary data, necessary information. So it is very important for us also to look into that. More arrest and successful prosecution of suspects. This is one area where suspects are arrested, but prosecution is not following. So it is very important that the criminal justice is involved to make sure people who are arrested in connection with wildlife crime are effectively prosecuted. More seizure and arrest locally. This, in the year 2002, when we started working, most of the African countries were rated, their enforcement effort were rated at 001. And this was done mainly in comparison with the seizure made outside the country against the seizure made locally. So now I think it has changed a bit, where we see more seizures done locally than outside the countries. And we need to pursue that to make sure we progressively take control of the illegal trade. In terms of challenges, the main challenges encountered comprise in terms of compliance by parties. And compliance by parties is not, it should not be seen like a result of inadequate or lack of willingness of countries to address the vice. But it's generally also connected to the incapacity, financial incapacity of some countries to comply with the agreed protocols and the regulations. For the task force, we have also a challenge which is linked to limited geographic scope. As I said, this agreement is for all of the African countries. So out of the 54 African countries, at the moment, only 10 countries are actively participating in the implementation of this agreement. And the scope of the activities of the task force are limited only to these 10 countries, including in addition to their neighboring countries. So it is very important to look into this to make sure at least all the countries are taken on board. Inadequate funding is also one of the hindrances in what we do. Weak legislations in most of the countries, and we need to continue strengthening them. In conclusion, we call upon the international community to support the Lusaka Agreement Task Force and assist state agencies in buttressing our effort in safeguarding of African smart treasured wild fauna and flora against illegal activities. Adequate funding availed to relevant organization at appropriate time is vital. We urge Cape Town University, the University of Cape Town, and the Global Initiative to join voices with many other organizations in encouraging the Republic of South Africa and all other African states who have not done so to ratify and accede to the Lusaka Agreement on Cooperative Enforcement Operation directed at illegal trade in wild fauna and flora. Driving the agenda from within is better than taking the risk of moving alone and be misunderstood by others. Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. The last time I stood in a lecture hall like this that gave me the, you know, the butterflies was when I was an undergrad in UK. And when I stood up to speak, I would get so nervous that I would get tunnel vision. And I would literally be unable to get my thoughts together and speak. So earlier today when we were told, you know, reimagine, we need new solutions, we need to reimagine. Actually, we need to reinvent ourselves, and that's really what I had to do. What we're facing worldwide in terms of biodiversity loss, and in Africa in particular, the loss of our magnificent species, it's just unthinkable that we don't do whatever it takes, even if it means we have to reinvent ourselves. Yesterday, as we were in the room, we actually had a straw poll. How many of you were in here for the straw poll? Okay, so the straw poll suggested that the room was divided. You know, the issues are not simply black and white. So let me try a slightly different version. How many of you in this room are poachers? Let's see a show of hands. I want to see all the poachers in the room. Okay, there aren't any. Will, where is he? Okay, how many in the room are traffickers of wildlife products? All right. How many of you would love to see elephants and rhinos go extinct? The truth is, there is an enemy out there. And the enemies are the poachers, the guys with the guns, the guys with the bows and arrows and the snares. The enemies are the guys who are trafficking ivory, rhino horn, and other wildlife products. We are not the enemies. We come into these meetings and these debates and we act as if we're fighting each other, when in fact, the truth is we're all actually on the same side. And I want us to all remember that. So we do have different opinions. We come from different stands, but we are all on the same side. I'm from Kenya. I was born and raised just outside of the city of Nairobi, and I fell in love with wildlife at a very early age. I know that Kenya has very different policies from South Africa. But deep down, we all believe in the protection of this magnificent wildlife heritage that we've inherited. We take it for granted that these animals are going to be with us for generations to come. Kenya is home to one of the longest studied populations of elephants in the world, in Amboseli. These elephants have been studied for 42 years. Every single elephant in this population is known by name. We know most of their birthdays. We know their cousins, uncles, aunts, sisters, brothers, mothers, and fathers. I mean, they are extraordinary animals, and everything we know about elephants is just revealing that actually we're just scratching the surface. We're only just beginning to get to understand these amazing pachyderms. This is Kumquat, matriarch of a family of 39, one of the most famous elephants in the world. Kumquat lived in Amboseli. She takes her family all the way into Tanzania, walks thousands of kilometers. Her entire family is named after the letter Q in the alphabet, so there's Kumquat. Behind her is Quantina. Behind Quantina is another daughter, Quay. Q-tip is the little grandson, and her youngest daughter, Kwanza, is the little baby in the back. Kumquat was famously photographed by Nick Brandt in Amboseli on the 27th of October 2012. The very next day, this was the photograph. Kumquat and her entire family were gunned down. That's Quantina. Because we knew these elephants, we could tell their stories. We could appeal to people. But it's not just Amboseli. This is Bonsai in Samburu, an elephant studied by Ian Douglas Hamilton and the Save the Elephants Project. Big bulls, Leruka, in Masai Mara. And of course, Satao. Satao, probably the biggest elephant in the world, shot by a poison arrow on the 30th of May of last year. When he died, I wrote a blog on The Guardian, and it got hundreds of thousands of hits, and people were calling me and they were crying. They were just so disturbed that this magnificent elephant had been killed. And I was like, have you met this elephant? And they said, no, but we've read the stories about him. And that outpouring of grief really surprised the Kenya Wildlife Service and the Kenyan government, who initially decided that maybe we should pretend this elephant didn't even exist in the first place. I was really moved by the story of Kumquat, though. This is where the campaign started. Kumquat shot. The person who killed her was arrested. He was charged with killing three elephants and putting a baby elephant under a lot of inhumane treatment. The poacher's name is Peke Shoke. He escaped justice. He ran across the border to Tanzania. He got rearrested. He kept getting bail. Just last week, Peke was found guilty, and he's been jailed for 1 year. He'll serve about 4 months, maybe, and he's been fined 40,000 shillings. That's 4,000 rand. So the campaign that I started really aimed to address this injustice, the injustice that our wildlife face in Kenya. And it's really because we treat wildlife as something dispensable. The offenses against wildlife are considered to be petty, not serious crimes. But we can't just blame and put the attention on the place where the animals are being killed. We really have to address the problem of where this ivory is going. So the ivory markets, as you probably all know, are China, Thailand, Vietnam, Philippines, those kinds of places. And the ivory is being used to make sculptures of things like gods and Buddhas. The decline of elephants in Africa is something that few people really have become really conscious of. It's something that has become the background, the wallpaper. Every year, poachers gun down 33,000 elephants. 33,000. That's more than all of the elephants in Kenya to supply a market for carvings like this in China and Thailand. If the Chinese went to England and said, you know, we really like those big rocks in that place called Stonehenge, they would make really nice buildings. Do you think that the British government would say, all right, you can start chipping away at them? If they went after the Statue of Liberty and said, let's make something else out of this scrap metal. I mean, it would just be seen as a declaration of war that anyone would dream of touching a national monument. How is it possible that Africa is standing by while people are eliminating, annihilating, it's like a genocide, taking out our monuments, our elephants, our rhinos, our pangolins? It's an issue that makes me so angry that I have to get other people to feel the same ferocity. So this is where the campaign started, hands off our elephants. It's really a campaign to say they're ours. They're our elephants, and you guys who are threatening them, whether you're a poacher, a trafficker, or a buyer, You have to get your hands off them. The campaign is really simple. Three simple things we want to do. First, we have to win the hearts and minds of everyone in Africa to support our heritage, which is really about our identity. We have to eliminate the supply of ivory, the trafficking of ivory, which Bonaventure explained so clearly. Tons and tons of ivory. In the last week, something like 9 tons of ivory has left Africa and arrived in Asia. That's what got caught. That's about 10% of what really has been moving. And we have to extinguish the demand in the countries in the Far East in particular. So we chose a very unlikely champion to support us. We're very lucky in Kenya. We have a first lady who is absolutely magnificent. She loves elephants, and she joins us, and she campaigns with us. And because of her presence, we can mobilize thousands of people. We do marches on the streets. We demand changes. We demand action from the government. She's the only first lady in the world who is doing a wildlife campaign. It's something that I think really sets Kenya apart. When we first presented her this idea, she just fell in love with this possibility. Before this, I mean, you all know, first ladies do campaigns, they do children, orphanages, health, you know, all the usual stuff. We showed her this image that you will be a convener of first ladies. You'll be able to attract other champions to this cause. You'll be able to get Kenya's sporting heroes to participate. You'll be able to reach the president himself. So when we say reimagine, we really do have to reimagine and actually create possibilities that were never there before. We have other champions. This is an amazing Kenyan man whose name is Giuliani. Anybody wants is on Twitter, please tag at Giuliani. He's a Kenyan hip-hop artist. And when I met him and started talking to him about elephants, he was like, well, you know, my gig is agriculture. And I said, yeah, but what about elephants? I said, let me take you to Amboseli. Come and meet these elephants. And the moment he saw elephants, he started screaming. I was like, what the heck? He's like really screaming and shouting at the elephants. And I realized he has never seen an elephant in his entire life. Giuliani grew up in one of the slums of Nairobi. He's now like this famous, you know, man with millions of followers. And he spent the day with us, with elephants, and with an incredible woman called Katito Sayalel, a Maasai woman who's been studying elephants for 20 years. She knows every single elephant by name. We're watching this elephant. He's a big bull. He's only 21 years old. He's not that magnificent, but he's all right. And Giuliani says, I love that elephant. I'm connected to this elephant. We're saying, okay. So then as we drive away, he says, I'm going to write a song for that elephant. And on the 28th of February, he launched a song for that elephant whose name is Grandis. And what Giuliani says in his song, and it's really amazing because we didn't feed him anything, but he says, have you ever met Grandis, the most elegant elephant in Amboseli? They say he won't make it to old age because his tusks will end up on somebody's neck. And Giuliani, when he sings the song, he really means it. He gets that the elephants of Africa are what make us Africans great. And he says, you know, I come from a land of greatness. I come from the land of Echo, who was another famous matriarch, and Grandis. So he put on a massive concert with Giuliani, Sauti Sol, another major Kenyan band, Emmanuel Jal. Any of you guys know Emmanuel Jal, Sudanese former child soldier? We put on a concert only about elephants, and it was phenomenal. The impact was really amazing. We had all kinds of Kenyan celebrities come for this event. So the campaign doesn't just reach out to champions like Giuliani, who are famous. We also go into the field, and we work with local communities. But the part of the work that I really want to talk about today is the work we do in the courts. So WildlifeDirect, on the one hand, we're doing all this public mobilization and campaign and getting everyone to fall in love with elephants. There's a reason why we're doing that. It's because we need the support of people to take the actions that need to be taken. We need people to lobby and pressure our governments to take the actions that need to be taken. So we sit in courts. We sit in the magistrates' courts across the entire country, and we monitor wildlife trials, and we report every single thing that's going on in those courts. We were able to show that 70% of case files were missing in the Kenyan courts. While there was a very high conviction rate in wildlife trials, the number of people who went to jail was less than 4% of those who were convicted. Less than 4%. And with this information, we went to see the Chief Justice. We presented him the report and the Director of Public Prosecutions, which resulted in some really amazing new reforms. The new law was passed in January of last year, which has the most severe penalties of any law in the world. Offenses against endangered species is now a fine of 2 million rand or life imprisonment. It's the only country in the world apart from China that has life imprisonment for wildlife crimes. We now have a wildlife crime prosecution unit, the only one in all of East Africa, and we've been supporting the government in training magistrates, prosecutors, and investigators. We have 566 new rangers because as a result of our complaints, the Treasury gave the Kenyan government $20 million extra to support anti-poaching efforts. And then we have our communities. Unlike South Africa, people in Kenya cannot own wildlife. They own land. And there's a lot of wildlife on that land. We have 150 conservancies owned by local people and private landowners, and that land is set aside for conservation. And this is where most of Kenya's wildlife resides. The president of Kenya burned 15 tons of ivory on March 3rd as a result of our protests and petitions, and he's promised to burn the entire ivory stockpile. The removal of these stockpiles is really vital because, as Bonaventure showed, all that ivory that you're seeing flowing out of Africa, I bet you anything, is coming from government stockpiles. It's not just coming from elephants that are being slaughtered yesterday. It's ivory that's been previously seized, and it's sitting in stores that are poorly manned or where people can be easily corrupted. And then there's the demand side, China and Hong Kong in particular. I went to Hong Kong earlier this year and I was told, whatever you do, don't show children pictures of dead elephants. So guess what I did? It's a really awful responsibility to actually show people pictures that break your heart. Those children were sobbing in their seats. But afterwards, they were running up to me and hugging me because they really get that all that ivory at home on the shelves and that their mothers are wearing is coming from the slaughter and the murder of these magnificent animals. And we put on events that we call Tweet for Elephants. And I hope some of you use some of these Twitter handles and hashtags. Tweet for Elephants. We did one, the first one we did with the American ambassador. And we basically went online and convinced, or tried to persuade everybody online to join in a conversation about elephants. In 2.5 hours of discussion with some of the most famous elephant conservationists in the world, we reached 36 million people around the world. And that's the power of, it's not just social media, it's the power of inspiring people to care about this. Elephants are an animal that are easy, really easy to relate to. And in the last event, we did a Tweet for Elephants, we did a debate, a much more difficult debate than this one, because we put people on either side of a very controversial issue, whether Kenya should destroy its ivory or not, whether Kenya should sell her ivory or not. And in that debate, one young man got on the stage and he just started shouting. And he had the microphone in his hand and he started shouting about, what are we doing? Why are we even discussing this? You wouldn't dream of discussing trade in panda bears. And he said, we need to draw a red line for elephants. And it really struck me that sometimes we do get all wound up in all the science and all the technology and all the facts. And it's simple. These animals should be sacred. In fact, in some African tribes in Kenya, elephants are sacred. You can't kill them. The Maasai believe that elephants are the ancestors of humans. How could you possibly kill them? So these are the kinds of things that are coming from the audience of non-biology, non-ecology people. These are just Kenyans young people, university students. Some of them are economists, writers, celebrities. Our campaign seeks to really end the trafficking of ivory through Kenya by making sure that everyone knows exactly what the penalty is if you do get caught. It is life imprisonment. And this is a message we're putting out in the airport, at the seaport, on the highways, and at the border posts. And we partner with corporates like airlines to make sure that our messages get seen by all the visitors. 80% of the people arrested in our airports with ivory are not Kenyans. They're usually people in transit who stupidly picked up something in Kinshasa, and before they know it, they're in a jail in Kenya. I know jails in South Africa are not very nice, but I bet you jails in Kenya are much worse. Probably our biggest feather in our cap is this fellow, Faisal Muhammad Ali. We made him famous. This is the guy who was fingered as the kingpin behind a seizure of ivory in Mombasa last June. Initially, they wouldn't even charge him with the crime. I stood with a group of my friends and my staff in the office of the Inspector General for 8.5 hours until he would see us, so that he would accept a letter from 400 Kenyans saying, arrest this man. Faisal, while there was an arrest charge for him, there was a warrant, nobody would touch him. He's too powerful, he's untouchable. All this stuff everyone says, you know, you have to just try and park it. In the end, we managed to get Interpol to be requested by the Kenyan government to help out, and they arrested him on the 23rd of December of last year. It was the best Christmas present ever. Some of the major wins that we've seen. So this campaign has been going for only 2 years. Elephant poaching has declined by 50% in the last 12 months. Rhino poaching is down 40%. And this year it's right down. South Africa has lost 431 rhinos as of today. Kenya's lost 3. Kenya has about 1,400 rhinos. If you look at it proportionally, South Africa is losing between 7 and 8%. Kenya is losing around 1 or 2%. So it's different, and it has a lot to do with the relationships we have with our communities, but also the pressure is here. The cartels are here in South Africa. If the cartels came to Kenya, I can assure you, we'd be in a very different situation, which is part of the reason why I'm here. Kenya cannot afford it. For if the reopening of rhino horn happens in this country, Kenya will lose every single one of her rhinos. So what's all this elephant stuff got to do with rhinos? For me, it's actually really quite simple. Rhinos are not that huggable compared to elephants. Elephants are animals that we relate to very easily. Rhinos is much more difficult. We have to work even harder to get people to fall in love with rhinos. I know that in this country, I've heard so many lectures in the last couple of days about how rhinos are an asset. And that just simply isn't the way we see it in Kenya. Rhinos are individuals, they're animals, so are elephants. And we're really afraid that if the South African government presents a proposal at CITES next year here in Cape Town, and it passes, because some countries will be very sympathetic, it is the host country. If such a proposal passes, and rhino horn gets sold into China and Vietnam, what will happen is that stigma, which all the campaigners have been trying to get, you know, entrenched and tattooed on everyone's mind, that don't buy rhino horn, don't buy rhino horn, that will disappear. You dump rhino horn into the market, and the first thing that will happen is the price of rhino horn will drop slightly, and there will be this huge, enormous body of people who couldn't afford it today because it's very expensive. All those people will suddenly be able to afford it, and they will buy it because rhino horn is a luxury item that a lot of prestige is attached to. That means the demand will explode, the price will rocket up, and the profitability for poachers, it'll just be heaven for them, and they will go after every last rhino. The scale of poaching will be something we couldn't possibly even imagine. Even if rhino horn trade doesn't open, we still have a crisis. We still have to work together. One of the biggest challenges and maybe the biggest shame of what's happening is that every country is scrambling and trying to do everything on their own. Kenyan forces are struggling under increasing threat and pressure to stop the poaching. I monitor every single trial of wildlife crime, and what I've seen is that a Vietnamese man arrested in Nairobi carrying rhino horn never gets communicated back to South Africa, where he probably got those horns from. It means that the same guys can operate in different African countries because there's no conversation going on between the countries. There is a complete lack of coordination. It's as though we know there's a crisis, but we just simply haven't thought, how on earth are we going to work on this together? When it came to Ebola, the whole world got together. I mean, I don't understand. We're about to lose a whole species, and the world isn't coming together to have a coordinated response. It simply doesn't make sense to me. But I don't think it's hopeless. I know there are a lot of people who look at what's happening and think, I can't bear it. I'm not going to look at another photograph. You turn away from Facebook pictures and all that kind of stuff. I'm still very optimistic. And I'm optimistic because of people like this young man, Richard Turere. Richard is a 15-year-old Maasai boy who I met when he was 13. At the age of 11, Richard was saving lions without even realizing what he was doing. He's an inventor. He's a kid who grew up in the bush without a book, without a computer. And he figured out how to trick lions into thinking that he was awake at night and protecting his father's cattle when he was actually asleep. And he did it through putting together wires and bulbs connected with an indicator box from a motorbike and a car battery, and he had this flashing light system going that looks like somebody's walking around. It's a really brilliant little invention. Richard is not an A-star student, but he's a problem solver. And this is what we have in Africa, which is really unique, is people who are so innovative and quite fearless. He's not afraid of failure. And people said to Richard, what if the lions figure it out? He says, then I'll come up with something else. And that's the kind of spirit that is unique to Africa. And it's because of people like Richard that I think we can make a huge difference. Richard grew up in the bush. As a result of his invention, he's managed to get a scholarship to one of the best schools in Kenya. And just today, we got an offer of a scholarship to Dartmouth University. And with those kind of changes, what we can do is transform the communities who live with wildlife on those landscapes. And I believe that that is how we're going to save it. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. And first and foremost, I'd like to thank the Global Initiative Against Transnational Organized Crime for bringing together all these expert talkers and presenters on this very important issue in our lives. As a prosecutor, it was a great challenge to me to discuss the law reform as well as challenges in 10 minutes. So by no means is this the exhaustive list of everything that we find challenging in the job, but the things that I struggle with the most in this field. Now, whether trade is legalized or not has got nothing to do with me. I'm a prosecutor. There will never be an end to poaching in South Africa. A hijacker will never buy a car where he can shoot someone dead and take it by force. So, but from my point of view, I have to look at what I can do from my side in law enforcement to bring a solution to the table. Now, the only thing I can think of at the moment is to amend legislation. At the moment, prosecutors have certain acts to our disposal to use, but if we look at how the courts are imposing them and the sentences, we have wonderful legislation available, yet we're not making a difference in this crisis. The survival of any endangered species is often it's a risk due to habitat loss. So this is the opposite thing where rhinos are concerned. We have a healthy environment for them to live in. They are being decimated by poachers. So where is the problem lying? In this scenario, I believe it's criminal for us not to act. Therefore, the PALSA document is something I was asked to come and discuss. It's the proposed amendments to legislation, which involves putting the offence on a higher scheduled list in terms of the Criminal Procedure Act, so that bail applications, there's a more distinct onus on the accused to prove that his release is in the interest of justice. Currently, bail for rhino poaching is a Schedule 1 offence. Therefore, the accused is entitled to be released on bail. If we can change that and up it to Schedule 5, then the magistrate must have more, he's got more power to refuse bail. Challenges in brief. Corruption. It's the white elephant in the room. Nobody wants to address it. Nobody wants to go there because it's not politically correct to say that. But corruption is the thing that makes my job difficult. You have to work with a certain amount of people. If you bring one new person into the chain of command, everything goes to waste, because there are people infiltrated in every single chain of command where enforcement is involved. And these people are clever. They do it on purpose. You would put a person at border control. You would put a person in a court or in the police or in whichever unit that deals with this. Otherwise, you can't succeed in your racket. Organized crime, I think that's obvious to everybody. This is not committed by on the spur of the moment people. This is a very organized type of offense. And one of the most, the highest paying illicit activities in the world. Our criminal justice system, like I said, bail is the issue. Everyone is always saying, why are the magistrate releasing these guys over and over and over? And I will address that further. Recently, we've got new problems with Asian language interpreters. They do not want to come to court. The embassy doesn't want to supply interpreters. And if the interpreter comes, who am I to say is interpreting the correct things? I have no clue. So it is a real big challenge. And it's no use we say, oh, that guy was in prison in Thailand for drugs. Let's use him. He's learned to speak the language, because immediately he's not an objective, a sworn-in interpreter as we need. We find that syndicates, when you struggle to get an interpreter, say, don't worry, we'll bring one. That's the biggest mistake you can make. My question is, when there's no rhinos left, what species is next? They do not stop. I just saw a picture on the internet of hornbills. A stack of hornbills in a room. What are we doing with hornbills? What's this new trend? So they'll just move on to a next species and a next one and a next one if we don't say to them, enough is enough. Syndicates need corrupt government officials to succeed, and they are on their payroll on every level, like I've said, and they are specialist employees in a syndicate. We need a pilot, we need a vet, we need someone who can administer M99, who can get hold of M99 to shoot the rhino. Therefore, it is also a division of labor within the syndicates. Economic growth, this is a big headache, because in every single country in the world, if you weigh the environmental right against the right of the human as economic growth, the environmental rights going to lose. It's in our policies that we must look at economic growth. But if you keep on tapping the source, what is going to be left at the end of the day if we don't look at this in a balanced manner? Links to organized crime, I think this has been played to death. Just in brief, the primary motivation obviously is economic gain. There's no other reason people get involved in organized crime. It's not because it's a fun business. It's a very high-risk business. But we can, from the studies done by the United Nations, it's about a $20 billion industry. And that's what we know from data that is gathered. But most of it's illicit, so you go do the math. I'm not very good at that, so I'm not getting involved in economic discussions. So these environmental syndicates are also aided by the government's lack of training of police officers, the lack of political will to fight these criminals. We always are one step behind, And that is because they do infiltrate every single step of the way. For instance, your Kenyan guy, Paula, Mr. Faisal, we have one here, he's called Navara. Everybody knows he's in charge of at least 20 groups in the Kruger National Park, but he gets to leave at will, crossing the border left, right, and center. Why? Someone in our park warns him. That's how they roll. So, challenges, for instance, the Chumlong case. Everyone was so excited when he got 40 years imprisonment. I said, wait, people, wait for the appeal. Because a murderer in this country doesn't even get 40 years. Life imprisonment plays out to about 25 years in prison. So why are we going to send an animal killer to jail for longer than we kill someone who kills people? I sat in that case while the judges were deliberating. Judge Nafsa was sitting in front with Marley van Heerden. She was in court arguing the matter on behalf of Alan Simpson, who did the case to begin with. And they begged her to say, give us a reason why shouldn't we diminish the sentence. At the end of the day, from the first instance court, where he got 40 years, which is a regional court, it moved to the High Court on appeal. Those judges diminished it 10 years to 30 years imprisonment. And in the SCA, the Supreme Court of Appeal, it boiled down to 15 years for all the crimes committed. And that mathematically boils down to about 6 months per rhino. There were 26 rhino involved. Why have we got a law that says if you poach a rhino, it's 10 years imprisonment if we're not going to enforce it? But the judges, I'm not criticizing our judiciary. This is, we must see this in the context of our criminal, our milieu in South Africa. We have many serious crimes to deal with on a daily basis. There's a nice photo of Chumlong and his reward for himself. This case was a clear indication that it's collaboration between parties. Chumlong didn't do this by himself. The farmer, which is still a contentious issue, there's still a civil matter pending for the stay of prosecution, which judgment is expected someday soon. This was permit abuse. Now, who's in control of permits? Looking at you, Francis. Sorry, I didn't mean that, but the department. In their right minds, how did they think all these young girls are going to shoot the rhinos? There was not a lot of thinking going on there or collusion. Now, farming an endangered species creates a market for poachers to infuse their illegal products with illegal products. There's no way we can tell the difference. And I'll show you a photograph later of a seizure on the Bangkok airport. Legalizing the trade in species will push the animals even closer to extinction. End of the story. It's just too easy for the poachers, because now there's a market and there's a demand. Therefore, the PULSA document proposes, first and foremost, more strict on bail, and a minimum sentence of 15 years imprisonment when an elephant or a rhino is poached. The legal reasoning behind that is if I'm an owner and someone steals a product of a value of more than 500,000 rand from me, my big BMW, for instance, there's a minimum sentence attached to it of 15 years. If a group is involved and the product or the value is 100,000, the sentence is 15 years. Now, we all know a rhino is worth more than 100,000 rand per rhino. Therefore, if for theft you can get a minimum sentence, why not for the theft of a rhino? If you're killing it, you're removing ownership permanently. There's no turning back. Therefore, it's important that in this current state, I do not believe legalization will happen soon. If the government decides to propose legalization on the COP meeting, it certainly is a process that won't happen overnight. It's years and years. There's got a lot of things that have to happen. So in the meanwhile, what do? We have to up law enforcement. We have to up awareness. We cannot stop the campaigns. I'm not going to bore you with the exact schedules. The document is available on the internet to see where the changes, and it's not difficult to enforce these changes. It only needs to go to public participation process, to the Exco committee, to the parliament, and to the government gazette, and boom, your legislation is changed. Another tool that we use as prosecutors is the Prevention of Organized Crime Act. It's a bit more complicated. It drags cases out. It makes them longer. It makes them, it makes the high-class lawyers come to the table, and they are experts in frustrating the criminal justice system. They will fight you on the tiniest issues. They will fight you on whether this decision was right. They will fight you on everything except the merits of a case. They will take you to court on every little thing except stand there and say, are you pleading guilty or not guilty? No, that's not the game. Because the longer you're frustrated, witnesses lose interest, witnesses die, witnesses get lost. It's a whole big circle that goes wrong. So where racketeering is involved, you don't focus on the event itself. You focus on the organization behind the event. Who, why, what, who's responsible? A normal crime is event-based. Something happened, we go, we investigate, we try and see who did it. Now we are trying to see who's the organization behind events that are similar to each other. That is not always easy to prove organized crime. You have to have more than two events, and it's quite complicated legislation. So that photograph is a photo of a legal permitted hunt in the Free State of a black rhino. However, after the hunt, I heard that the buyer of the horn wasn't happy because the horn wasn't big enough. So generally, you would first see, you know, do your circumference, how long, and then you shoot the animal and say, okay, I'm happy. No, it doesn't happen like this. The next one is an illegal hunt, Mr. Chumlong, one of his victims. The seizure on Bangkok, that's just to show you how they traffic these things. This was in hand luggage, carried through scanners, through the OR Tambo airport. Five horns were seen, the photograph on the right-hand side. And this is my point about infusing legal and illegal trade. Four of those horns were illegal. One had a permit number on. It's still dodgy how it got out of the country, but just to prove to you, out of the five, only one was permitted. Where did the other four come from? That poor rhino died for no good reason. His horn wasn't even taken. So that was in the Kruger National Park during 2006, one of Dion van Deventer's victims. He had to run away for some other reason. The cars came, or he was distracted at that moment. Or actually, in fact, he shot, the rhino ran, he didn't know she died, and she was just left there. There were four of them that were killed in that manner without horns being removed. That's the effect if you use etorphin or M99, on a rhino, and that is what a rhino looks like after it's been dehorned and it's grown back. Yes, it grew back beautifully, didn't it? It looks very not good. Doesn't look right to me. Now, I'm sure I made this joke before somewhere, but I'm throwing a freaking bone in there, but this is lion bones, and it's the same people. It's no secret. And why? Because tiger bone aren't easily attainable. Now it's lions. It's the next best thing. Hence, if rhinos aren't there, where are we going then? So the lion bone trade, and that's a very difficult one, because if I apply for a permit after I've hunted a trophy, why can't I take the bones home with me? How are we going to address that issue? This is another bogus product that is, in my view, extremely ridiculous product, because they make wine out of it. They do all sorts of strange things with the product. It's not just rhinos, elephants that are being decimated. It's every single living creature out there. This is just a small case from Oudendal's risk court in Free State, where the one guy in a shop was found with a whole cornucopia of different types of products. We have tortoise shells, we have otter skins, we have an owl, and that's, we had sun gazes and a lot of bulbs, plants and things. So it's really not isolated just to rhinos and abalone and elephant or ivory. So in closing, whether there's legalization or not, that's to me not the solution. In the meanwhile, we have to look at law enforcement and really put pressure on government to change the legislation. No amount of MOUs or things are helping us at this moment. There's another seizure, and you'll see in the background the chopsticks there, ivory chopsticks. Rhino horn bracelet. I did mention this morning at a certain workshop that to me, in the vicuna and the rhino horn trade parallel that's drawn, at least with the vicuna wool, you can make a useful product like a scarf or something. But with the rhino, it's hair and nails. And then it was pointed out to me that there are beautiful things made out of rhino horn, and I just remembered about that bracelet. But really, we can make bracelets that look similar to that without having to kill a whole species. That's one of the famous photos, I think, that appeared in Nat Geo of one of the first discovered syndicates in South Africa, which was the Van Diemen brothers, whom I prosecuted, and he received 10 years imprisonment till this date. I think he's the person who sat the longest for his poaching crimes. He was released after five. There's nothing I can do about that. That's part of correctional services. I did my utmost. They released him after five, which to me was still, it's still a good stint that he did. There was some of this, the crime scenes, the horns that were taken, the one with the plastic over it, that's how we did forensics in 2006, where you physically matched it. There was no RODIS system involved, all this wonderful DNA. And abalone poaching is just another one of the products that they are involved in. In the last 4 months, we at least got 5,000 kilograms of abalone in the Free State. That's just the through fare from Eastern Cape and Cape Town to Joburg. The allowable catch is 150 tons a year. Poachers are taking 1,500 tons. It's not sustainable. Strange, you can open or propagate breeding farms. They do not want the breeded or the harvested abalone. They want the wild abalone. It's not the same. All of those were seizures in the Free State. We are geographically well placed to dry abalone. That was a drying facility in Bethlehem. The weather there is ideal for drying abalone, cold and dry. Don't cry, Paula. Here comes Satao. And to me, it's just, if a person can kill one of the last five big tuskers, I mean, go to hell, really.
Good evening. I almost feel like the previous speakers had insight into my presentation because they've said everything I want to say. But it's working. If you look at biodiversity crime, can everybody hear me? Biodiversity crime is linked to other crimes, as people said, drug trafficking and human trafficking. And the problem is that exorbitant money is paid for some of these animals or products. And pound for pound, some of the species or products are worth more than gold or even drugs. Challenges presented by the illicit online trade is a new thing. And we've caught quite a lot of people, and we used the online trade information against them, and specifically the prices. And the result of that was that they actually took the prices off the internet so that you can't use it against them. And you now have to register to be in their circle so that you can get the prices. The nature of environmental law in South Africa has also become increasingly complex, and I'm going to say a bit more about that. And obviously, nature conservation organizations face a growing problem with regard to staff retention, the capacity and obviously funding. And without funding, nothing will happen. So, you know, biodiversity crime involves a lot of things. And we've caught people from the UK coming to collect baboon spiders, illegal hunting, this is springbok, illegal game capture, illegal trade in birds, illegal flower picking. This case in the top was a guy that we caught in Swartberg with 88,000 proteas that he picked illegally to take out to overseas, and he was represented by Francois van Sail, who did Diwani. So that's the type of guys you get against you. But he was prosecuted. On the bottom, we have Mr. Uman with the hat on his head, who's the curator of the Prague Botanical Gardens. We caught him collecting succulents. And next to him is Mr. Ayasi, who's one of the world, or Dr. Ayasi, who's one of the world experts in Orpheus, which is dwarf aloes. We caught him in Oudtshoorn collecting Orpheus. So, you know, all people do it. And you can break it up into more or less three groups. You get your, let's just call it your scientist, who comes here and to collect a lot of things. He knows that he's not going to get a permit to collect 50 or 100 of one species. He knows when to come. He knows what's the right time of the year to come and where to collect. And he can do a lot of damage in a short period of time. Then you get your pet trader. And they like vacuum cleaners. They collect everything they find. And then, obviously, your syndicates. So if you look at the environmental crime cycle, I'm going to talk about where the arrows are, the last piece. What do you need to prosecute somebody? And, you know, what is the objectives of enforcement? It is to monitor when the objective of compliance are focused on behavioral change of people, and it includes monitoring effectiveness of implementation of the planned interventions. In other words, what you do, does it have an effect, the desired effect or not? Promote compliance of legislation, policies, and guidance and guidelines. You know, it's a lot of time if you say people, please, you know, do it. You will find people that will adhere to it, and you don't have to do anything more. And then obviously, the investigating of the people who's not adhering to any legislation. And effective enforcement requires clear legislative mandates with penalties that serve as an effective deterrent. That's really important. Effective, efficient monitoring and inspections, and efficient permitting systems, and you've heard all of this before. But it's really important that the people doing these, especially the monitoring and inspections and effective permitting, that they do the right things and issue the right permits and ask questions before things are issued. Because a lot of laundering takes place with permits. And human population also can be roughly divided into three groups. You get the non-compliant, the compliant that can be encouraged to comply, and then people who will be generally compliant. And when you do enforcement, it is really important that in order to enforce, for enforcement to be an effective deterrent, there must be a high probability of being caught. And at the moment, that is not the case. The response to violations must be swift, certain, and fair. That's also not happening all the time. And the penalty must serve enough to outweigh the potential benefit of non-compliance in the ideal world. Now, if you look at the South African situation, we already live in a complex South Africa with lots of issues. The state coffers are overwhelmed with comprising funding priorities for all other departments. Legislative mandates are fragmented, which limits the implementation of enforcement initiatives. What I mean by that is, you will get the guy at the border who's from Department A. I'm going to mention names. And he's only responsible to look for why. He's only looking at why, focusing on why. And as long as the guy produces the why permit, they don't ask for the A permit that might be required by nature conservation. That's one of our big problems. And that's how people come through borders. What I also mean by that is that you'll find that all nine provinces has got their own provincial legislation that differs and all got different permits, although they might be the same, more or less. And on top of that, you've also got national legislation. There is seemingly a flow from, at the moment, from compliant and pliant population groups in South Africa to non-compliant, because there is no effect if you do something wrong. And the relationships between conservation industries and other institutions are often troubled. And that is, we often seen as the enemy because we don't want to allow them to sell certain things or to collect certain things in nature, or the whole game farm issue at the moment. You know, they want to keep certain animals and we say, no, you can't, because for whatever reason. So that's also aids in people doing things illegally. Due to the diverse nature of the African natural environment, nature conservation resources are spread thinly to cover as many priority areas as possible. That's just a fact of life. And South African reptiles, birds, insects, succulents, you name it, is on high demand. The thing is, you get unique animals in South Africa, and especially in the Western Cape, where you get the famous biome. You only get those plants here, and you get animals and plants that you will find nowhere else in the world. That in itself is an attraction to people collecting those particular animals. To get it, he has to come here, and he has to come and poach it. And that is one of our big problems. The poorest borders of South Africa is another problem. It's very easy to take things through borders. And obviously, I said before, corruption. To go through borders for things is very easy. And South Africa's state as a tourist destination also allows easy infiltration by foreign collectors. And we've seen it. The people we've caught, they come here on holiday. They book in on some of the reserves, or they visit the places where these animals come. And they book a day hike on a nature reserve, but he wanders off the trail because he knows in that specific peak there's a colophon beetle he can collect, and you're going to find it nowhere else in the world. He carries a camera bag. The thing is the same size as a beetle. It's very easy to disguise and take out. That's the problem. And this is just examples of what I'm saying. That very first photograph on the top is Cordylus lizards. That was a Japanese pet trader. It was caught in Frindal. He collected 57 of those lizards in one morning in one copy near Bitterfontein, and he actually wiped out the entire population. And that's R1 million. He made it in half an hour. That's why people do this. On the paper next to it is colophon beetles. That's three brothers from Germany that we caught with colophon beetles. They collected 253 of those beetles. And I don't like giving prices, but some of these beetles were selling dead for $10,000 each. That was in 2005. Because you only find them here. And if you're a beetle collector, that's the holy grail. If you haven't got a colophon in your collection, then you haven't got a beetle collection. Lately, we've also caught people with pangolins. And in the bottom there is the orpheus that we took from Dr. Yassi, the pictures I've showed you. He had over 300 of those, and some of them were described as being trophy specimens. Now, the problem that you get in trying to prosecute these people is these people are experts in these fields. They know these things better than some of our own experts, and they're prepared to fight your identification for weeks on end. And it makes things difficult for the investigator and for the prosecutor. So the way to do it is a partnership approach. Biodiversity crime should be treated as one treats a virus, addressing the symptoms in a focused manner in order to enable the victim to overcome the effects of the virus. Now, what do I mean by this? I'm going to give you an example. We had big problems in 2001 till 2005 with illegal tortoise collectors coming from Germany and Slovakia and Czechoslovakia. The guy who was doing the demand was sitting there, and there's no way we could get to him. But each time they sent people, we were fortunate enough to catch them. We caught 9 groups of them in basically 3 years. The majority of them got direct jail, and they sat in jail. And since 2005 up to today, touch wood, we haven't had another tortoise case. So that does have an effect. Bearing in mind that there's no silver bullet or once-off, one-size-fits-all solution for biodiversity crime, and the multifaceted solution is required. It is essential that cooperation between countries, provinces, is improved to tackle biodiversity crime on a regional or provincial level. And what I mean by that is you'll find, for instance, that in the one province, a particular snake or a particular species is protected. They would go and poach it there, take it to another province where it's not protected, apply for a permit to take it out because no questions are asked, and then export it. That's what they would do. There must be buy-in from all levels of government, and effective partnerships and networks must be built between various stakeholders. And it's easier said than done. Corruption is a big problem. And we that are in the game for some time, we know who we can talk to and who we can't talk to. And sometimes it's a matter of finding out who's on duty where. And then you decide, okay, well, we can't get the guy caught here. We'll take him there because that guy's on duty and we'll know he'll get caught there. There should be a free and fair exchange of information between departments regarding biodiversity crime. And again, corruption is a big problem, especially if you've got information and you want to catch somebody. So the recommendation that I'm making is, in order for compliance enforcement to effectively encourage and enforce behavioral change, the following resources are required. Dedicated, trained, equipped personnel. What I mean by that is on all levels. The guy on the ground doing patrols, the permit officer issuing the inspection, the permit, the guy doing the inspection. And it's not just doing the inspection, he must understand what species he's looking at. Because a lot of times they would simply call something else, and it's not that. And they would take species that look alike. And it's very difficult to identify if you don't know what you're looking at. That's what they do. Dedicated, equipped, and staffed wildlife forensic lab. That's one of the problems that we've got, although they are addressing it, and a lot of forensic work are being done, much more than you could have found 5 years ago. And I know there's plans to expand it at the moment. But for instance, there are certain things that cannot be done in South Africa at this moment in time. And if you want that information, you have to send the samples overseas, and it's very expensive. Training material and manuals for operational staff, for instance, custom officers and custom guys, to train them and to show them, you know, what these things look like. And giving them regular PowerPoint presentations and talking to them and showing them what to look out for really works. And I'll show you examples of what we've got. A database and staff to design and maintain them. So if you need information of who's got permits or who doesn't have permits, that you can get that information quickly. At the moment, it's quite a struggle, especially if it's on a weekend, to get that information. And secure evidence storage facilities is also a problem. You know, you see 50 eland. Now, what do you do with them? Where do you take them? We haven't got facilities to put them. Or 1,000 snakes. It's easy to store something that's dead, but something that's alive, it's not that easy. And as I've said before, adequate funding is essential. Without funding, you're nowhere. So an ideal investigation, prosecution, would include the following: a network of all relevant stakeholders involved in the investigation, all working together with a common goal. Everyone knows what he's doing. Everyone is capacitated. A team of dedicated, trained, and equipped personnel conducts the inspections and gathers evidence. Because at the moment, a lot of times, we'll find that somebody from a different department will discover a parcel, or at the courier services, somebody will discover something, and they take their bare hands, open it, rip it to pieces, no gloves are used, you can't get fingerprints, that kind of things. And then sometimes that's really important to get that. A dedicated, trained prosecutor is involved as early as possible in the investigation, from day one. That's really important. The forensic evidence is analyzed by trained staff and according to standardized protocols and procedures. Upon finalization of the investigation, the case is heard by a trained and capacitated judicial officer, and obviously done by a trained prosecutor. Charges in terms of relevant legislation are put to the accused. What I mean by that is you just don't charge him for the conservation ordinance or conservation bill. You charge additionally. You charge him, we've now recently discovered that for people that transport, for instance, things on planes, in terms of section, I'm not going to call it, of the Civil Aviation Act, if you transport animal products on a plane without a permit, you can get jail sentence of up to 50 years. So you must add those things. Charge him for SARS. Get the asset forfeiture unit involved. Yeah? You cost him a lot of money, and he really feels it. If you just charge him under one thing, and he might get a fine and get away with it, but if it's five or six different legislations that's been contravened, the effect on him is much bigger. And then if he's found guilty, you must testify in aggravation of sentence, and that really makes a big difference, and I've seen it myself, having testified quite a lot of times. And I'm going to give you an example of just two of the cases we've done recently. Cheng Jiliang, Tableview, he was caught with 1 ton of ivory in 2 storage containers. Everything was done properly. We had fingerprints on the boxes that the things were packed in, fingerprints on the plastic bags that the ivory was wrapped in. We even had photos on his cell phone where he photographed the things before they were sewn up. So we could use all those things, and he was found guilty. And he was sentenced to 10 years direct imprisonment, of which 3 years were suspended on condition that he pays a fine of 5 million rand within 12 months. That's the biggest fine that I know of for ivory in Africa and probably the world. And the people involved, SAPS, the Hawks, the fingerprint people of the SAPS, forensic people, marine enforcement, and CapeNature officials, all working together for a common goal. And that's what you'll get. Another example. This guy was caught now recently at Cape Town Airport. He had 42 grams of rhino. 42 grams is this, but it's small. Okay? 3 lion claws and 3 kilograms of crocodile meat. But he was sentenced to 25 years imprisonment. He was also charged under the Civil Aviation Act for trying to transport things on a plane. He was on his way to Hong Kong. And eventually, some of it was suspended for 5 years, but he's sitting in jail for 18 months, and he paid a fine of 40,000 rand for 42 grams of rhino. That's also, again, because we testified in aggravation, and the people worked together. So we can do it if we all work together, and we've got the right people doing it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Paul. I think you'll all agree it's been a fascinating evening. We're really getting to the nitty-gritty of the issues now. Unfortunately, we've only got about 10 minutes for questions. So what I propose doing is taking 3 short questions and then dealing with those and then 3 more short questions.
Good evening. Antoinette, this question is for you. Regarding the legislation change, you went through the processes there. Have the wheels been set in motion now to get the legislation changed in terms of changing the bail from Schedule 1 to Schedule 5 and increasing prison terms? And if so, whereabouts are we?
Correct, it hasn't been set in motion yet. The document's been drafted. However, I don't know if you know about the Global March for Elephants and Rhinos, which is a global initiative where 137 towns all together on the 4th of October last year marched on Animal Day, and that document was delivered to all the embassies, the Chinese, or the 20 states that we believe are the users of the product. The document was delivered to our own parliament. However, that's not the way to change. You don't just change the process out of the sky. It has to go through certain definite legal processes, for instance, going to the Exco Committee, going to Parliament, and then from there, the changes in the Government Gazette.
So that process must still be taken to all those steps.
And those steps, Antoinette, will take at least 3 years, by which time we'll be a lot further down the road with the rhinos on the way to extinction. I want to know from you whether in any prosecution for rhino poaching you have put expert evidence before the magistrate or the judge hearing the case with a view to aggravation, as Paul put it, being taken into account when it comes to sentencing. As far as I'm concerned, the family silver of the nation is being stolen by armed gangs who are invading our country. Now, if this is brought home to the magistrate, he surely does not give a slap on the wrist type of sentence. If evidence of the kind that we've heard from presenters here tonight, last night, Monday night, is placed before a court and is not contradicted by the poacher, the accused, the syndicates, then surely we will get more severe sentences, greater deterrence, in a far shorter period of time than we can do it by way of the legal process. The decision to disband the Scorpions was made at Polokwane in 2007, December, and that it had to be urgently disbanded. The legislation was not brought onto the statute book until 2009. So, yeah, and that was urgent. I don't know how urgent biodiversity legislation is regarded.
In our courts, there has been such evidence. I personally have not dealt with a case where it was necessary. The one the one syndicate I dealt with, Van Deventer, was a plea agreement. Therefore, you do not place aggravating sentence on record. You already agree on the sentence pre-hand. In fact, a month ago, I placed expert evidence on record in an abalone trial, if that helps you a little bit. We're still awaiting the outcome. So, yes, the process will take long to change the legislation. However, if we don't start now, are we going to wait another 3 years and then say it's going to take too long? So any step that we can take to put pressure on our government to up the legislation is as soon as possible. It's important to do it.
Can I take two questions at once, one there and one there? In other words, sorry, one after the other before we answer.
Hi, this is actually to any one of you who can answer this, to be honest. Is there anything being done with regards to cyber, like a cyber division in terms of crime, wildlife crime? Is anything being, I mean, I understand that this is incredibly underfunded and understaffed. That's a major issue. But is anything being done with regards to that, like monitoring sites, particularly things like Gumtree and things, I mean, the exotic pet trade that, Paul, I'm sure you deal with this all the time, has a major implication, particularly with things like sun gazers and stuff like that. And this stuff is getting freely traded on Gumtree. And, I mean, is there anyone that's sort of tackling that?
A question for the South Africans. Again, do you think that this the public emphasis on rhino horn is drowning out the attention or removing attention from other species smuggling, like the rare lizards and things? Or do you think it's adding attention to the general problem? I'd like your impression on that.
With regard to the cybercrime part, I got phoned by Colonel Steve Roots at 5:30 the other morning asking me, did you know in America they have a crime that if you even advertise on the internet endangered species, that it's a crime? So there is someone looking at it. There are experts in this country that I know. I personally work with, Colonel Van Yeden, who's a cybercrime expert. He's one of the four in the country. He's passed his Mossad 24/7 exam, and he's constantly monitoring the internet. But as Paul pointed out, Gumtree is not in South Africa. The suppliers in America, it's very hard to get information. You have to start a mutual legal assistance program. So there's a lot of schlep, but there are people looking at it.
I want to just to give a small example on in terms of cybercrime. I know it is not very prominent in most of the African countries, but some years ago, we had a case where a young Cameroonian based in Congo at the coast we are trading online. And the case was investigated together in conjunction with U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. They were able to follow up all the transactions online, and it took almost a 1 year investigation to establish all the transactions which were done by the criminals. And at the end of the day, we had a full report on what happened. We needed now to move forward to locate from where he was operating from, because online you don't know exactly from where he's operating. So we moved forward again another 3 months just to be able to locate from where he was, then move there to be able to identify and locate him properly. And we did it again another 1 month. I went personally to Congo Brazzaville for at least 2 times, and we were able to locate him and to identify where he was. And he was arrested in conjunction with Interpol, NCB. So it is possible, it can happen, it is happening even in our countries here. But it's not easy to deal with cybercrime.
Thank you. Could somebody respond to that last question about whether it's a distracting issue? And then I'll take 2 more questions.
The question was, does the focus on rhinos take attention away from other species, or does it shine a light on wildlife crime in general? And I think, personally, I think it's the latter. I think, yes, we do shine a light on species like elephants and rhinos. They are issues that grab our attention. And for a lot of people, it's the first time they become present and aware to the fact that there is this massive demand. I mean, most people have never heard of a pangolin. Most people have never seen a pangolin. To hear that there are about 10,000 pangolins being ripped out of Africa every year is amazing, because nobody ever sees them. So I think that it's actually created a huge amount of awareness because these two animals, elephants and rhinos, are so charismatic.
Just to respond to your statement there, whilst working in the field, we've realized that the majority of South Africans know about rhino poaching, know about elephant poaching. But when asked what is a pangolin, most of them don't even realize it exists, let alone that tens of thousands of them are being ripped from Africa. When asked about things like dugongs, people don't realize the plight of the dugong. So I would say from experience in the field, that yes, the hyper emphasis on rhinos are kind of slightly taking away emphasis on other environmental issues, other poaching issues, especially in South Africa.
My question is to Antoinette. Maybe it's not very fair, but I just want to know what should be done to take these kingpins into custody. I mean, we all know who they are. And we know they come and go across the border without being touched. And I'm sure the government knows about it. So what do you suggest being done?
Elise, have patience. But the problem, like I say, it's our own people who warn. Let's use Mr. Navarro as an example. There are horror stories of what he's done in Mozambique too. Two journalists, Belgian, I'm not sure if they're Belgian, went into his village, Mashingir, asking questions about him. They were subsequently arrested. The police stood aside while Mr. Navarro came in and questioned the journalists. When asked whether they wanted to assist with bringing to book, they said they're never coming back, they never want to see Mozambique or South Africa ever again. But that's the problem that we're having, is while we have people in charge of enforcing these crimes or investigating them, that's my problem, that's infiltrated. The guys, it's wolves in sheep clothes. Of course they're going to warn Mr. Navarro. Of course it's going to be difficult to arrest him. But please, I shall not rest until the day that we catch them in the South African border, and it's possible. It is possible.
I think any attempt by me to try and summarize the contributions this evening would really not do justice to the richness of the information which they conveyed, and I'm not going to attempt to do so. I'm not going to try and deal with the content of the excellent contributions. I just noted for myself one aspect I'd like to comment on. If you look at these five presenters, the sort of one word that emerges that impressed me, it is commitment. It's an unbelievable commitment amongst these five in whichever field they find themselves, law enforcement, et cetera, et cetera. I think that's impressive. It almost causes you to say, well, what are you doing? We need these campaigns. Paula talked about successful campaigns in Kenya. One needs commitment for that. And I think we should not create our own comfort zones with workshops, which are essential, but there's more work to be done. I don't want to go through the entire list of thanking all role players. We've done so with the co-sponsors. We've done so with the donors. I do wish to thank you and also the participants of the previous evenings for really an excellent turnout, a fascinating discussion. Sometimes testing, sometimes I myself found it very difficult not to become engaged. The presenters had a standard which I've very seldom seen stretching over three nights at such a level. One person needs to be thanked before I close off, and that is the person who's had all the frustrations in planning this, in dealing with prima donnas, in changing flights, in last-minute cancellations, etc. That is Kat Kuzain, who is Mark Shaw's assistant in the Institute of Criminology. I'm not sure whether Kat is here. I saw her earlier on. But she really has worked very hard. So that one... Somewhere at the back. Thank you very much for coming. I do believe that even my friend John Sellar was quite right in making the point that conference after conference after conference after conference don't seem to be having the necessary impact which we expect. This type of debate on a platform which the university has offered for discussion, for different views to be aired, really by an audience, too, by participants who are prepared to discipline themselves to enable such a discussion to take place. We need more of that. We really need more of that in many aspects of not only wildlife conservation, protection, in other crucial issues which face South Africans as well. Thank you very much for coming. Good night, safe traveling, and see you again.